hands. If you know how to pray in the spirit, begin to pray. Come on. The Bible says that out of your belly shall begin to flow rivers. Come on, let's get the river flowing in this place. Come on, let it flow. We come that at the ocean, Remekidi Biakata. Shank come that at the Ura Basso, Remekidi Biakato. Shank come that at the Ura Baba. Come on, let it flow, let it flow. We come that at the ocean, Remekidi Biakata. Shank come that at the Ura Masso, Remekidi Biako. Shank come that at the Ura Mama. Come that at the ocean, Remekidi Biakato. Overflow, get in the river. Yes, Jesus. Ha-ha. Spirit, lead me. Come on. Let it flow. Come on, let it flow. Out of your belly shall flow. Ha ha. Come on, activate your river. Everybody's got a river. Come on, activate that river. Yeah. Kam da da di o shib re me ki di bi a ka ta da di a so ko. Raman kam da da di o shib re me ki di bi o re ma so ko ta. Kan da da di o re ba se re me ki di bi o re ma so ko ta ta. Aramakada, come on, let it flow. Let it flow. Ramakanda de Oshim Rebakata. Come on. We got a river on the inside of us. Ikanda de Oshim Rebakata. Yes, Spirit, lead me. Pray.
Spirit, lead me where my trust.
Come on, don't stop. Pray. Apply pressure to that river. Let's catch the current.
Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. Then my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. stronger in the presence of Savior. Spirit, lead you in my turn without borders. Me walk upon the water.
There's healing in the river.
You
there's deliverance in the river. There's joy in the
take
river.
Take me deeper than my faith could ever
yes.
wonder. Then my faith would be made stronger
yes.
in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, when my trust is without borders, and me walk upon the waters, wherever you come.
Don't stop. Don't stop. We're about to hit a gusher. Come on, don't stop. Pray. Pray.
Pray.
Pray.
Take me deeper.
Revelations. Revelations 22. Jesus. Every hand lifted up in this place. Everybody lifted hands up in this place. Father, we honor you in this house. We honor you in this place. Thank you for the river. Thank you for the anointing that flows from the river. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Living waters. Living waters in this place. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercies, Lord Jesus. Thank you, 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 Lord Jesus. Yes. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Father. Father, we thank you for your presence this morning. We honor you in this place. Let it continue to flow, Lord Jesus. Saturate this place. Let us be like those that were drunken with wine, Lord Jesus. That new wine. Father, let that river cover every dry place. Let it cover all fallow ground, Lord God. It'll begin to break up that very fallow ground, Father. As the word of God is about to be sown in every heart, I thank you, Lord Jesus. Let that water saturate that ground and prepare every heart to receive it. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. On your way back to your seat, tell somebody, I got a river of life flowing out of me. I got a river of life flowing out of me. Amen. You know, as Bishop said that, quickly, Revelations 22 came to mind. And Revelations 22 and 1, listen to this. And this is the last chapter in the Bible. He says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb, in the midst of the street of it. And on either side of the river was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Verse 3, and there should be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. Get in that river. Get in that river. Stay in that river. Every morning I wake up that I remember, I ask the Lord, give me that living water. Amen. Well, let's watch this quick video, then I'm going to have a few words to share with you, and we'll go and get some fish and chicken. Amen. And if there's no video, I'm ready to roll. Either way, I'm good. All right. Bless the Lord. Well, you can go ahead and put the PowerPoint on up then. I'm so excited. Usually when I come, let me get them down. Usually when I get to minister on Sunday, especially in the presence of Bishop and in the presence of you all in this awesome Sunday morning, I wait for him. And when he shows up, I know it's time to roll. You know, I'm taught well. We can do nothing but by the Spirit of God. Amen? Amen? Well, my wife, she's over preaching to the youth. I'm over here. Bishop and Mom are here. My mom's over there. You're here. Your mama here. Your dad and them here. Your family's here. We got Barbara and J.R. Gorham's team in the children's church ministering to your young people. We got nursery back there. The babies are being ministered to. We are. Amen? Amen. Well, of course, we're in the theme of faith. And for the whole month, we're going to be talking on faith. And so, you know, my topic today is faith cometh. Faith cometh. You know, in Revelations 22, I believe the same chapter, I love the Bible. I love my word. I do. That's my best friend. The word is consistent. This day and time, you need consistent people around you. Most of us have inconsistent liability relationships. You ever have friends that every time they call you with something? Well, when I go to Jesus, he's the same. Sometimes you can't even handle it because he's all good. He's always good. But I love the word of God. And I will say this to some of you. We were looking at some percentages just the other day. Our marketing director shared with us percentages of those that read the Bible. And I know that that's not true of this house. But it was saying that maybe less than 19% of the body of Christ read their Bibles daily. 19%. And so, you know, we're usually around at least, you know, about 1,000, 1,200, 1,300 some people on a Sunday morning. So looking at you guys, that would put us maybe around, if it was just maybe 19%, I'm going to give you 20%. That ain't a lot. So that means that when the word of God is being preached to you, you can only receive part of it. Because there's nothing working to get it. You don't have anything. I can't make a sandwich if I ain't got but one piece of bread. I can make a snack, and a snack won't last me to dinner time. But when you come here, you don't come here dry. You need to already be in the river. You need to already be in the word. So when you come, it adds something to. And listen, if you don't know the word, you can't pull from the man of God because you have no faith that's enlarged to come and get it. So you come here like a dead battery wanting somebody to lay jumper cables on you and kind of kickstart you. Listen, everybody don't drive a manual. So everybody don't know how to jump a car off. What you just do, you get up in the morning and see what happens is, see, the more you're in the word, the more you grow. The more you grow, the more you know. The more you know, the more you realize what you don't know. Amen? Man, I'm getting like, boy, I tell you what, I'm aligned up under Bishop and Lady Joyce. I promise you, I can sit in my Bible, and time makes no sense to me. Oh, it gets so good. And you begin to realize that God loves you that much that he wants to share with you his revelation knowledge. I will tell you, you will not get revelation knowledge if you're not consistent in the scripture. God can't trust inconsistency. He can't trust you. Because you're a part-time lover. You know, when I was growing up, we called them ticket time. You ticket time. Let's get started. Faith coming. Let's go right into the word. Let's open up in Romans chapter 10. And we're going to have some fun today. I love sharing the word of God. I love being before the people of God. I was just looking at you all worship. Let me share with you something really quick as I get into this verse here. It was a second Monday morning prayer. Like most of us, we kind of wake up around maybe 4, trying to get here on time. Well, I had one of them like visions in between me trying to get up and actually get up. You ever tell yourself, okay, get up, Brother Chauncey? You say, okay, now get up. Like I'm gonna need you. Well, in between that, I had a vision. And it's the Lord, and this is right before that prayer that morning, I was in the admin building, and it was 5 a.m. prayer. And the interesting thing is the building looked different than what it is now. It's almost like we had added sides to it because it had a balcony, but it was the same front. Everything looked the same. And as I was there, I saw people coming down from the right rafters and the left rafters just pouring in there for that Monday morning prayer. And this is the Lord showing me this. I know it was God. And then immediately, the Lord picked me up off of my feet. And I began to kind of drift over the tops of people, almost like you're sitting here right now. And I was like, okay, now it's getting just a little weird. Now I'm just saying, what scripture do you be lifting people up? But anyways, the Lord began to show me the span of people that, and it was full. But for rows, I can see like a burgundy cloth over a lot of people. And certain people, they were just kind of still, they were unclothed. I mean, they were fine. They were just sitting there looking regular like themselves. And the Lord began to show me a lot. And most of the people that were coming to prayer had the burgundy cloth over their heads. And I was looking for some deep meaning. And I said, well, Lord, so what's this? He said, you see the ones with cloth on your head? I said, yeah. He said, they're here, but their hearts are far from me. He said, they're acting out, and they're praying, but there's no revelation knowledge. They're just going through the flow. They're just kind of going through the motions. And what I don't want to happen is that 5 a.m. prayer. I don't want you coming just to come so we see you coming. See, what we just kind of tapped into, that's nothing to what God wants to show us and explode your very world. You need to be so saturated with such a residue of his presence, and it comes from prayer, and it comes from the word. It doesn't come from TV. It doesn't come from just mere me preaching to you. It comes from that one-on-one time. And I'm not coming off on you, and I'm not challenging you to the sense, but I want you to realize that when you come to prayer, come to with an ear to hear what God has to say, and come with a fervency. You know, I remember, you remember we used to, how many of y'all used to remember when we prayed on Wednesday nights? Y'all remember that? I know, forget it, man. I was up on that little altar. I was single then. Now y'all single pope, y'all should be leading the bunch of holiness. If you single, the Lord says, you can give all your time to me. I'm just saying. Little side note, that was just came off the dome real quick. But I was up there just praying, just he come, da da ba ba, I'm just going. And Mama Abby tapped me on the back. She said, son, you ain't praying. I was like, wait a minute. I looked to my left. I looked to my right. I was doing everything that they was doing. She said, no, you got to get deeper than that. And that night, excuse me, that had to be 98 when I joined this church. That night, something opened up to me about prayer. Oh, it's another realm other than just closing your eyes and just moving your mouth. My God, I can tap into something. When I pray, I leave this place. You're not even here when I'm praying. I'll be in such prayer for this hour. I feel like sometimes when we're closing, we're just starting. There's so much more than ritualistic, sweet hour. Now, God says, if you at least spend an hour with me, that's what we want. But I'm like, I like that. Ooh. I like to get so deep in the river. You know, Shark Week has been on TV, and some of y'all have been catching some of that. Do you know that the ocean is so deep that it's unexplorable to humans? But there's something else down there that we have no knowledge of. It even said it gets so dark, you can't even see it with the naked eye. But with the spiritual eye, God can reveal those things, and he wants to. He says, I investigate the deep matters. You're sitting home complaining about not having a job or this kid acting a plum nut or that. God says, I want to talk to you about the deep matters. I love what the pastor said about the root that's going on. Man. But anyhow, the Lord showed me that in prayer, and my expectation is as we go forward that cloth will begin to be ripped off of rows of people. And we'll all have such a good time in prayer. I want to leave out of there about like that right there. Or just sit down. You understand? Not thinking about my schedule, what else has got to happen today. Romans chapter 10, faith cometh. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report? Come on. So then faith cometh. Faith is in motion. As we're saying the word right now, we put power on the word by way of the Holy Spirit, and it goes into the place that it's supposed to prosper. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Now, you're in the environment. You know, when I look at this scripture, I immediately go to Mark chapter 4, the very parable of the sower. In the parable of the sower, you have four states of four different people. You got the wayward folk. You got the people that's caught up with the world. You got the people that have stuff junked up in their heart. Then you got the good ground. Let me say this. We all expect to get to the place that where our heart's in good ground. But that's a process. See, while we're sitting here right now, while I'm speaking to you right now, the word cannot profit some of you because you're in unforgiveness. You're in envy. You're in strife. Let's continue to move on. Yes, verily their sound went into all the earth and their words unto the ends of the world. Next slide. Faith cometh. You know, it's interesting because the King James Version is with an E, but in the New Living Translation is Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 6, when the Lord begins to reveal himself to Isaiah, and he cleans him up, and he purifies his tongue, he takes coals from the altar, touches his tongue, changes his words, then he says, I'm going to send you. He says, you're going to have a message, but some people ain't going to hear it, and some people ain't going to believe it. He says, so what did I do? He said, you keep preaching it. We're living in a season now that there's a falling away of the body of Christ. But I'm not alarmed, because if you read your Bible, it said it was going to happen. Now, I believe, and you call me old school, old-fashioned Bible, fail, hellfire, brimstone, whatever. I believe that things are going to get so hot in the world, people are going to run to the church. So I want to say this. If you're holding up somebody else's seat, that's all I got to say on that one. Faith comes by way of the word. The word gives us vision. We see in the word and we hear the word, then we act. Next slide. Now, this is the Message Bible, and I like this translation. Romans 10 and 17, it says, but not everybody is ready for this. As nice as we look on Sunday mornings and as many Bibles that we have and as much time we call ourselves being a believer, some of y'all, if you've been saved 10 years, raise your hand. You've been saved 10 years, raise your hand. Keep your hands up. If you've been saved 12 years, raise your hand. I'm going to go down. If you've been saved 5 years, raise your hand. 5 years, you've been saved. That's what's up. We got some 10-year-olds in here. We need to see more fruit. You've been walking with the Lord 10 years? Have you planted a soul in the house? Have you shared the gospel with anybody? Or are you holding it secret like you don't want nobody else to know? But not everybody is ready for this, ready to see, ready to hear, and ready to act. Isaiah asks, what will I ask at one time or another? Does anyone care, God? Next slide. Is anyone listening and believing a word of it? Bishop has been preaching. If you've been here long enough, you know Bishop's heart. You know he desires to get us blessed. You know he's going to function in integrity. You know he's going to bring the word unadulterated, line upon line, precept upon precept. But I have to be honest. I personally have not bore fruit of everything that I've heard since I've been in this ministry. I should be so much further ahead. And I'm not just talking about financially, because oftentimes we think about the blessing. No, I'm talking about it spiritually, in my family, in my leadership, and who I am as an individual. Listen, this stuff matters, man. Listen, we're not just filling up space this morning. You know how accountable we are because of the word that we get preached and taught? That's right. When you come in here and you hear a good word and you say, amen, now you got to walk and live that out. Amen. And if you don't live that out, then you become a hypocrite. Wow. Sharing the cross last night, and I so enjoy, you know, sharing the gospel with anybody, but sharing the cross, I begin to see something and pick up some own tendencies of my own behavior, my own character. You know, the interesting thing, when Jesus sat down to have that last meal with the disciples, he said, one of you are going to betray me. All 12 wanted to know, is that me? So if all 12 who've been rocking it with Jesus 3 years, and they were tight, they didn't have some casual relationship. They slept together, ate together. They were in each other's environment, knew who stunk the most, knew who didn't take baths. They knew it was all, they knew all of that. They knew whose feet was ugly, whose feet was pretty. They all knew. I'm sure all of that came up in conversation. You spend 3 years with somebody? Jesus ain't just preaching and teaching the whole time. I'm pretty sure they was probably making jokes about one another and ratting on the other one and talking about, man, that nose hair, man, if you just trim that, you know, we may win one more soul. I'm just saying, that's kind of scary. But 3 years, there with Jesus, and he sits down to have his last meal with them, and he's at the table, and it's serious, because I'm sure they're beginning to wonder, why is Jesus dropping these hints, and why is he talking about he's about to leave and all these other things? Now they're sitting at this table with the 12, and Jesus leads off the conversation with, one of you are going to betray me. Then he moves on and said, all of you will desert me. And they like, there you go again. Talking in parables, probably halfway paying attention. But I begin to locate something in myself. Everybody has a trait of Judas. Everybody has a trait of Peter. Daily, we have opportunities to deny Christ. You can be in a place like this and not even engage in worship. You're denying him, you're rejecting him. And I believe that sin in itself don't take you to hell. What takes you to hell is rejecting Christ. Because we all have sinned. We all have fallen short of God's standard of living for us. We have all done that. But when you reject Christ, to him it's a sense of betrayal. But if we go back to the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 53 speaks about he's going to be born, he's going to be rejected, and he's going to be despised. Now you think about all of the people that's hurt you. You think about all of the people that's betrayed you. Is your love that resilient that he still forgives you? He still loves you. he still wants to rock with you? Think about right now that person that owes you $20 and you ain't spoke to them in 3 years over $20. $20. Some of y'all are like, yeah, $20. You mess with my money, you mess with my emotions. But Jesus says, I'll still accept you, I'll still forgive you, and I'll still reject you. Even Jesus was rejected by his own father when he had to die on the cross for our sins. When God laid the sins of man upon Jesus, even he had to turn his back because he couldn't look on sin. So he knows when you and I are not functioning in the will of God. And whether you know it or not, that's betrayal. I can only betray a friend. I can't betray an enemy. I'll say that again. I could only betray somebody whose team I'm on. Because I expose him to the enemy. I know secrets. And betrayal means that I'm going to open him up for the enemy to get in to get him. I can't do that for my enemy because we aren't on the same team. We ain't going the same way. God can tell you to turn your TV off and get in my word. And you can simply say, not right now. And you're the same person that blows up Cherie Blue's phone to get a meeting with the bishop. You're the same person that's in every line that comes up here when there's a prayer line. You're the same person that never gets a breakthrough. But when he says, turn off that TV, not right now. See, this is Housewives, and this is like the reunion. I'm going to get to you, Lord. You know what the Lord says? Go on and sleep. Son of man has been betrayed. Go on and take a nap. The interesting thing, and I'm not in last night's message, but it's just showing my heart. He even told Peter what he was going to do, and he told Judas his character too. You've been told about your character, but still there's no change. Listen, scripture says, Hebrews chapter 4, the word of God is quick and it's sharp. If I ain't getting cut up when I'm in the Bible, then there's a problem. My blade is dull, and I need to sharpen that sucker. You feel me? Y'all rocking with me? Come on now. Before you trust, you have to listen. I think it's a trust issue. Because you're doing everything you're supposed to. You come to church. You come to prayer. But there's no fruit. You're still cussing people out. You're still not walking in love. You've not yet developed in the simple things of God. And the scripture says, well, you ought to be teachers. You're 10 years in the Lord. I can't bring my gifts to St. Peter's. They don't recognize me. Bishop ain't called my name in 3 years. I'm one of the biggest givers down there. Well, you know what? Let's just put your name on the wall. How about that? Let's just put your name on the wall. Will that make you feel better? Oh, you give. You do that. Hold the way you preach. Let me tell you something. I don't get up to share the gospel to hear compliments. I'm going to say this for what it's worth. I have learned from my leadership. I'm under a whole nother level of trial. Amen. When I can get up before you and share it. So I put myself in a worse place. If I can share the gospel that I ain't living, that's the biggest hypocrite. You know, and Judas never said nothing. See, everybody recognizes Peter. Peter's always being scrutinized because he's just overt with his sin. Everybody knows him. Every night, knows he's going to put his foot in. He's going to do something dumb. But it's the Judas that nobody recognizes. It's the Judas that sits back quiet in the back, and he's sitting back, and he's in agreement with everything, like, yeah, but he's just waiting on this opportunity. No, you go ahead, Peter. You go and get out the boat. I just sit here. No, you good. I'm all right. I don't need no fries. I'm good. Sold Jesus 30 pieces of silver
which is the price for a common slave. Everybody's got a price. Your Judas has got a price. Sometimes your enemy, somebody that you don't like, they get vulnerable, and you may take a lick. That's your price. That's your price. Some people, you just reject people. You just, you know, you just shut them down. No, I don't want to deal with you at all. That's your price. Let's move on. But unless Christ's word is preached, there's nothing to listen to. Let's go on. Can I trust you? It simply comes down. In relationships, there must be trust. This is the question that sometimes we ask God, and this is the question, and I believe God comes right back to us. Can I trust you with my revelation? Can I trust you with my gifts? Can I trust you with those talents? How many people have let them down? If there's no trust in your relationship, then there's no foundation. The reason why some of us are not producing fruit is because we don't trust the word. Oh, yeah, you say it, but your heart is so far from it. Our heart is connected to a default of hustling. That's all we know. All we know to do is get one more job. All we know to do is just do what I said I'm going to do because that's what daddy told me to do. I don't know nothing else to do. And you come in here and bishop say, let's believe the word. Okay, I'm trying to do that, but I'm going to probably stick to this because I trust this. See, as I said last week, when you trust, you got to step out on faith. And sometimes it's just not the balancing act. It's just the fact that you stepped out. See, all it takes is one step. God is not asking you to run a marathon. He's not asking you to do something incredible, something overarching from your character, because you know some of y'all ain't going to do nothing. You want everything to be handed to you. And a very small percentage of us step out of the boat. We're like a Peter. We'll get out of the boat, but why am I going to get out of this boat when I'm just saying somebody better catch me? I'm going to step out, but you know I can't swim. Now, Jesus stay right there. You know, it's funny. You know, I've been taking Jason and Isabella to the pool, and Izzy's not as confident as Jason. And so when I tell her to jump off the side, she's like, I'm going to need you to come a little closer. I'm like, Izzy, I'm right here the whole time I'm trying to back. See, if I don't back up, she'll never jump. Or when she jumps, she won't know what to do when she gets into the water. So sometimes God is like, just jump. I got you. Come closer, Jesus. What you're really saying is make it clearer or tell me everything I'm supposed to do. And he's like, I've already made a way of escape. I've already given you my word, but you still got to jump. I can't make you jump because I'm not a dictator. So you got to choose to serve me. It's got to be your will. If it's not your will, then it can't be done. I can't force you. See, I'm not like these other gods. I'm not into ritualism. Everything with me is based upon faith. Faith is undefined. But through your experience with God. I remember when I responded to an altar call. You know, I didn't have a clue what was going to happen after I repented of my sins. But day, after scripture, after verse, after prayer, after tithe, after love, after walking, after making mistakes, after all of that, I'm seeing growth. I'm not the same that I used to be. You have to get to the point that there is no plan B. Ain't no plan C. Ain't no, you know, GPS, it'll give you a reroute you. I don't need no reroute. If I need to be in traffic, then you call me to be in traffic because I believe that I'm on my way to this place because you told me to go to this place. But most of us, we have so many plan Bs. We got so many things working. Let's move on. John chapter 6, verse 63, this is so important. You got to catch this. It is the spirit that quickeneth. Faith cometh. Faith is moving. It's in motion. It's the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The flesh is your past. It's the old default system. It's gotten you nowhere. Yes, it's gotten you a few dollars and maybe a 3% raise, but the reality of it, you're still connected to the world system. The words that I speak unto you, my God, they are spirit. They're not carnal. They're not flesh. They're not going to make sense to your human nature. They are life. This book that we have, this Bible, is life to you and I. I know as you sit in those seats that there's challenges. I know that there's doubts. I know that there's issues going on. I know that there's things going on in your life that you're just not connecting the dots. That's why he said, I give you my word. And see, the challenging thing with our culture is our word is no longer our bond. So when somebody says, even God says, I give you my word, you don't even know how to trust that because your word is not your bond. So your relationship is not bound, don't trust. It's about what you do for me. What you gonna do for me, Jesus, if I do this? And we get into this bartering thing. You want to negotiate with God. No, the negotiation, the deal was cut when Jesus died on the cross. That was the last deal that was cut. Jesus said, I really don't have to come back and do anything because I sent my spirit into the earth to run all of this. That was the last negotiation that was done. When he sent his son to die on the cross for our sins, deal was made, deal, all bets were off then. It was a done deal. He covered the bases. He had paid your bill. Eat all you want. That's what I love about God. As much as you want, he wants to give it to you. And the word of God is inexhaustible. You may think that you got a corner on the love revelation. You ain't got a clue, baby. I'm a psychology major. I know you ain't using but maybe 20 to 30% of that which you call your brain. You don't even know how it works. Psychologists don't even know how to work. That's why they practice on you and ask you all them questions. They're not God. You read one more book. You just so smart, just becoming dumb. The word of God is just as simple as it gets. Let's keep moving on. I don't want to take too much time. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning that those who believe not and those who would betray him. And that's when I'm going to get back to the betrayal piece. When your heart shifts, you release an aroma. Jesus don't have to see your sin. He knows when your heart is out of pocket. The scripture talks about in the book of Hebrews those that provoked him because their hearts lost trust in God. When my heart and your heart loses trust in God, it shows up in our actions. It shows up in how we love people. It shows in how we follow the scripture. You ever have people that you partially don't like? You know, there's this new thing. People say, you know, I'm feeling some kind of way. What is that? What is that even? What kind of way are you feeling? We just pick up stuff from the world and we just start saying it to try to define our, you don't know what you feel. You need to get over it. Amen. Because if it clips your faith, then you can't gain anything. All right. And the soon as that pager goes off or that beeper goes off in your heart, God says, okay, I can't trust you. You right now, I know. You know, he's seen betrayal, and he's seen what it does. So when we believe not, then we're open for betrayal. If you read the scriptures, when Judas went to go betray Jesus, there was opportunity for the Spirit now to enter in and to bring the connection. If you're not in the Word, then you have no shield of faith. So when it comes to try to trap you up or trick you up, you don't even realize it's come. You don't even realize that overnight your agenda changed. You ever woke up and you just mad at your husband or you just mad at your kids or you just mad at somebody in the house? And you wake up and you walk it out, don't you? I said, come, what? And everybody in the house is like, what is wrong with you? Last night when we laid down, you were fine. You were happy, you were joyful. But now, what is that? That's the problem around here. You take me for granted. You just rah, 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 rah. Then you come to Sunday morning service, and everybody's in the river but you, because you're sitting there like, wow, your worship has gone so long. You know I got, that's what I'm saying, that's why I don't like that church. We're in there all the time. Oh, we got to listen to him this morning. Oh, my God.
What he got on this morning? He just looked like, oh my God.
But I got a river of life flowing out of me. It makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. It opens up prison doors and set the captives free. I got a river of life flowing out of me. I don't want to betray Jesus. That means I have to be developed in my faith. God recognizes that we all have challenges. We all have little hiccups in the road. You know, everybody's river's not flowing. I read a book called Endued with Power. And this book began to talk about how certain people can't really walk in the fullness of God because have you ever seen a dam? You understand, I'm not cussing, a dam where the river is and the water can't get through because you got unforgiveness. You got little secret sins. You got other boulders that's just in the way. There needs to be power of deliverance to come upon you. Then you can move out of that thing and let that flow happen. I don't want my flow to stop. So when sin or temptation presents itself to me, just like it does to you, I got to quicken myself back and be like, wait a minute, casting down all imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ and having a readiness to avenge all disobedience. Once, it's a process, my obedience has been fulfilled. That word is in my heart. And I'm anchored with that sucker. So if something comes my way, I'm going to come back with the word. But if you're not in your Bible, you're not seeking God, when that thing comes, you know what I'm doing is accept it. God senses the betrayal, he backs off. You're needing God to move in that area. I can't move till you get that betrayal done. I can't go against my word. See, I've seen that betrayal before. See, I've seen Judas do it. I've seen what happened to him. The challenging thing with Judas sought his own atonement. Judas went to go get it right as opposed to going to Jesus. He went back to those that gave him the money to try to straighten the matter out. Peter said, you know what? Here we go again. Lord, I'm sorry. Forgive me. You said I was going to do it. I did it. You're right. Peter went on to live again, got another rebuke from Paul, and went on, had a great ministry, died the martyr's death. Judas killed himself. He sought his own atonement. He had his own plan. See, some of us are trying to reckon with the world. You need to reckon with God. Let's move on. 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able. For ye are yet carnal, but for whereas there is among you envying. They just got that new BMW. Oh, my God, that's nice. Your car may crank up and it may not. You sit at the stoplight too long, you may just slap somebody. You like, yeah, that ain't right. That's envy. You wear the same clothes to work every day. You wear the same clothes to school every week and everybody coming with some new stuff and you just like, that ain't right. I see more kids go home and get mad at parents because they don't have them what somebody else has on. You don't know what's going on in that house. That may be the only love that kid get. The only love that kid get may be a trip to the mall. Your mom and your daddy love you so much, but here you are. You're envying after something that they wish they had what you had. If y'all could switch lives about 30 days, you'd be like, you know what? I changed my mind. Keep your clothes, keep your shoes. I'll never see my daddy. I'll never see my mama. She ain't never hugged me. She ain't never touched me. I take what I got. Envying. Sensing a betrayal, strife. I tell you what, if anything, since I got this ministry in 1998, I done heard, get away straight. I didn't even know what strife was. Bishop said, stay away from it. Bishop even says, if somebody else is in strife, I don't want you nowhere around me. Certain things are contagious. Fear is contagious. You ever been around somebody that's scared of everything? Don't hang around them. I kid you not, to this day, my kids don't like spiders or ants because of who they was going with, some people they hung around. I have to make Jason pick up bugs just so the fact that he's a boy, I can't have you running an ant come in the house. It's okay for Izzy.
Pick that, pick it up.
We got to the point he was putting grasshoppers in his pocket, crickets walking, and you can't do that. Put that guy back outside. Mamas, let that boy get outside and get dirty.
That's right.
It may not be a man in that house. You let that boy fall, bust, skin up all of that. He'll be all right. Tap his knees. Every man in here that's a man worth his call got some tore up knees and some scars. Everybody fall off a bike. When he fall, let him cry it out. When you finish, now go ride back around the same street. Try that hill again. Try it one more time. This time, use your brakes. What? Mia, and I'm going to get home. Mia cannot stand it when Jason don't put on lotion. I kind of like it. B.S., are you all right? I cannot have my boy get more pretty than my daughter. I'm serious. You got to catch that at a young age. Y'all think I'm playing. Some of y'all know. Y'all know. Everybody ready to go except your son. You better check that. You better check. I'm okay even some days them not having no deodorant. You smell like a man, boy. Let me tell you something. You get them too pretty, ain't no woman gonna want them. PB saying how sharp Jason looked. Jason get his wife to dress him. I know better. I ain't that nice with it. Don't give me no credit I don't deserve. I ain't got no lotion on my knees either. And strife. Okay. And divisions. Watch out for people that try to divide, even in your family. Watch that. People, because that didn't happen in the family. Are ye not carnal and walk as mere men? Next slide. You were not able to bear it. What's the holdup? The holdup was the fact that you have not matured in the things of God. Next slide. We got to run. John 16, 12 and 13. I have yet many things so to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Listen, certain things God really wants to reveal to you because he hears your cries and he hears your prayers. But your maturity ain't there to make that kind of money yet. We're all on a test where we are. We're all on the test. And I don't care how tough it gets at times that you're mad at where you are. Well, change. Grow up in the little areas where you are now. You don't need a bigger house if you can't clean the little one you got. If you still got clothes in the corner, you still ain't got room for nothing, clean that up. Because if you get a bigger house, you're going to make a bigger mess. Then you're going to be bigger mad. I told Jason to clean his room up the other day. He was like, I said, well, don't mess it up. You don't want to clean it up. What you mad at? You made the mess. Some people are ashamed to bring people to their houses or to let. For what? You may have more God in your house than they got in their mansion. Well, I remember I was dating Mia, and Mia would come over to my grandma's house. You know, I lived on Cleveland and 14th. You know what I'm saying? I lived in the hood. And so, you know, Mia, she lived in Clemens. You know, that's that high real estate out there now. You don't go to Clemens on $5. You better have at least a 20. You know, you're going to be able to get back. See, I take the 40 split the other way. I don't keep going to the south side. And my grandma, she had bars on the windows, and we had aluminum side, and it was a beautiful home. I promise you, grandma took care of us. We was really nice, and my family all taken care of. But my house, man, you walk down the hall, man, you at the end of the house. You turn around and go back, you in the living room. You make a left, they go to the dining room, they go to the kitchen. That tour lasted every bit about 30 seconds. They go that room, they go that room, they go my room. It's the living room. This is the honest God truth. I remember one trip, my mother, she invited my sister and I to come up to New York. She's living in uptown Manhattan. And I was so excited because my mom was living in Manhattan. I just knew she had the biggest place, man. And we go in this door, and we go down this hall, and we see this big room. And I'm like, okay, this is nice. I say, so Mom, where's your kitchen? And she gets some doors, and she opens up the doors. That's the kitchen. Where's your bathroom? Bathroom's right there. Where are we sleeping? Right there on that floor, right there. That was my first introduction to inflatable mattresses. But let me say, where you are right now, be satisfied and know that God has you better for you, but don't want what somebody else got. You don't know what they go through to keep that. And see, secretly, we do it to each other. Secretly, we do it to each other. We don't even realize it. And it has us thinking like the world. Next slide. Howbeit then, he, the Spirit of truth, has come. He will guide us. We need to be guided of the Holy Spirit on purchases. We need to be guided of the Holy Spirit in every area of our lives. He will guide us into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself. Keep moving. The Spirit of truth, right here. The Holy Spirit searches out every matter. That should be in your relationships. That should be in your money. Who you going to marry? Who you going to let you have your children? All of that. When we align with his plan, we bear fruit. Jesus could not have come forth until Mary lined up. Samuel could not come forth until his mother Hannah lined up with the will of God. Certain things have to come into God's plan and God's alignment for them to release into your life. So you're believing God for things? Why don't you find the will of God and let him manifest his way? Okay, last slide. Let's keep moving. Genesis 1, then this is my last stuff right here. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Let's see how the Holy Spirit is here. And the earth was without form and void, and the darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. So here it is. The Word is not yet manifested in the flesh, but you have the Holy Spirit that's just sitting there, hovering over the deep, waiting and anticipating a command. The same way he is today, sitting in the earthly realm. Let's move on. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit's role was significant in its function. The Spirit responds or anticipates to the word or the word that is spoken. So if you're speaking the word of God, the Holy Spirit takes that. He begins to make something happen. Like, for instance, if God said, let there be light, God gives a command. Jesus walks it out. The Holy Spirit brings it to pass. I'll say that again. So for something to happen, God gives out the command. He tells you, he gives a vision of what he wants. Then he gives you a word on how to pull that forth. That's Jesus. Then the manifestation of that is the Holy Spirit bringing the illumination. So the Trinity is always in working with us. So you believe in God for wealth. You believe in God for this. You get the vision for what God has for you. He'll give you a word. Then you give the Holy Spirit the ability to anticipate that and give him something to work with. Then he enables your actions. He brings a desire, and he brings a hunger, and he brings a focus and a discipline to your life. Let's move on. Last but not least, John 1, 1 through 4, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Last slide, that's good. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for the Word. We thank you, Lord God, that faith is a force that's coming. Help us to learn how to catch it and what to do with it when it arrives. Right now, I want you to just open up your hearts right now. What's been robbing you of your faith? What's been destroying your confession? Where in life have you just been in envy, and you've been in strife, or you've been in some level of division, or maybe you brought the division? Maybe you're like Peter. You've been overtly in the wrong, and you just all about town, all your stuff is out. But I also want to recognize that Judas is in the house. You're secretly waiting for another opportunity to betray him. The Word of God has come to us today. I want to be fruitful. I know you want to be fruitful. So right now, if there's envying, strife, or divisions, maybe you're part of it. Maybe you're not. Maybe you're not initiated, or maybe you're in it right now. I just want you to stand to your feet. We're going to pray right here from your seats. And just be honest. I mean, I want you to be blessed. I want your faith to begin to start producing fruit. I want there to be things in your life. If you're not happy right now with what you're producing, just stand to your feet. And that may be everybody. You may be saying, hey, I could be further in this area. I know that there's areas in my life that I could be further in. And so here, the Lord told him, he said, listen, I want to give you meat. I want to give you something more. I want to give you everything you're asking me for. But right now, I can only give you milk because you can't digest what I have for you. You don't have the ability to understand and to actually work within the revelation knowledge, and you've not passed the test on this level. Faith comes. Faith comes, but we got to get our hearts right. Because if we're not trusting God, we need to repent about that, and we then begin to move in faith. And if you're in envy, you're in strife, and there's divisions among you, and you're part of that, I will tell you your heart is far from God, because God is not about those things. God is all about unity. God is about peace, and God is about literally just loving everybody. So right now, I just want you just to check your hearts. Just check your hearts. Talking about the parable of the sower. What offense is there? What's in your heart that needs to come out? It's holding you back. Some of you got challenges forgiving somebody. You need to let that go. If you don't let it go, then you're going to stay in that same state, stay in that same place for the rest of your days. That person that you want, you held back by, is going on about their life. They ain't even thinking about you. They done forgot about that $20. So right now, I just want you to examine your heart. I want you just to have your own conversation with the Lord right now. I'm going to pray a corporate prayer, and then we'll pray together. Father, we just thank you right now for the word of God. Father, we acknowledge right now, Lord Jesus, for the overt sin in our lives, oh God. Please forgive us, Lord God, whereby there have been envying, where there's been any strife in our life, oh God, and there's been divisions amongst us. Father, any levels of immaturity, Lord God, I repent right now in Jesus' name upon my own life, and I'm repenting now, Lord God, for this corporate body. Father, I ask you right now, by your Holy Spirit divinely, I ask you to begin to search out the deep matters of my heart. I pray that you begin to expose to me and expose to this body of believers right now, Lord God, those things that's been holding back our faith, that's been holding back the fruit and the actual excess and increase that you want to bring. Today, I lay my heart on the altar, oh God, and I acknowledge openly before you, Lord God, that I have missed it in some areas. I have fallen short in some areas. But today I acknowledge, Lord God, that I no longer want to betray you. Forgive me for betrayal, Lord God. Forgive me for betraying you in my worship, my time with you, or my time on this earth, in deed, in action, or in thought. Please forgive me for any betrayal in me. Holy Spirit, I ask you to annihilate every symptom of the flesh, every symptom of Judas or Peter in my life right now in Jesus' name. I no longer want to produce that fruit. That's no longer me. This day, I lay it all at the altar, and I thank you for your grace, and I honor you for your word. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. While they're praying right now, if there's anything else you need to get on your heart, this is not your time. Go ahead and do that. Just close your eyes really quick and just, you know, whatever it is, you may know what it is, you may not know what it is, but just pray a little prayer and just get connected to God. While you're doing that, if you're not saved, I want to call you down to this altar. I, like you, were in a place of waywardness. I've been to church all my life. I knew a little bit about the church, but I never had the church on the inside of me. Today's your opportunity. If you're not saved, your heart's not right with God, I want you to come into this house. Come on down to this altar right now. I want to extend you the right hand of fellowship. Nobody's going to judge you. Nobody's going to look at you funny. But if your heart's not right, I want you to come on down to this altar. I want to receive you and give you the right hand of fellowship. Amen. Amen. Your name?
Shanita.
Tony. Tony? Amen. What's your name? Jasmine? Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Anybody else? If you're not saved, today is the day of salvation.